Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. We are studying CNS, Central Nervous System. And today we have to study the traumatic injuries of the brain. First, we start with the perinatal brain injuries. The injuries that are inflicted on the newborn babies during childbirth. That may be intraperitoneal hemorrhage, interventricular hemorrhage, periventricular leukomalacia or simple infarcts, or cerebral palsy refers to non-progressive diffuse cerebral pathology apparent at childbirth. And that is mostly because of the oxygen deficiency during the childbirth. These are the few photographs of the brain injuries showing the intraperitoneal hemorrhages and the other infarcts. Now coming to this CNS trauma, that is one of the major brain injuries that may be inflicted during road traffic accidents or physical accidents, the falls, blunt injuries or something, and they are mainly skull fractures, parenchymal injuries, traumatic vascular injury, and their sequelae are the spinal cord trauma. The brain trauma includes contusions, lacerations or tears, coup or contre-coup, and concussion. This is the photograph of a contusion of the brain. Here there is hairline fracture of the skull bone. You can find the hairline. And on the right side, it's depressed or displaced fracture of the skull bone. The problems that our patient has to face because of the traumatic brain injury, there may be hematomas or hemorrhage. The hematoma may be epidural, subdural, maybe because of trauma, subarachnoid, maybe arterial or without any trauma, intraparenchymal, interventricular, maybe due to no trauma, or rare in adults, common in preemies. In this sketch diagram, you find the different types of hematomas that may be because of the skull fractures, and here you can find the ruptured middle meningeal artery and giving rise to hematoma formation. That may be epidural hematoma, and there may be dura stellate skull and venous blood, outer membrane and inner membrane. This is the subdural hematoma. This is epidural hematoma. You can find out it's under the above the dura mater, the hematoma formation, and that is also compressing upon the brain matter. Subdural hematoma, you can find out huge hematoma under the dura mater. This is the subarachnoid hemorrhage. You can, all the brain, base of the brain is painted with the blood, fresh blood. This is the intraparenchymal hemorrhage. and again extensive intraparenchymal hemorrhage in the brain matter. This is interventricular hemorrhage. Now, talking about the sequelae of the CNS trauma, that may be hydrocephalus, dementia, that is also called Hunchback syndrome, and diffuse axonal injury of the white matter. This is the brain injury and interparenchymal hemorrhage. Now, coming to the spinal cord trauma, that parallels the brain patterns of injury on a cellular basis, usually secondary to spinal column displacement, and level of injury mirrors motor loss, may lead to death, quadriplegia or paraplegia. This is the sketch of the spinal cord, vertebral column, and the level of injuries that can be inflicted on the spine. The results show in the patient, they look like that. In the cervical nerves, they will be involving head and neck, diaphragm, deltoids, biceps, wrist extenders, triceps and hand. In the thoracic nerves, these are the chest muscles, abdominal muscles and the lumbar nerves that will be involved in the affecting the leg muscles. And sacral nerves, they will be affecting bowel, bladder and sexual function. Now, cerebrovascular disease or CVA, stroke, we can define reduced blood and oxygen supply to the brain matter because of ischemia. There may be global, focal or acute edema leading to neuronal microvascularization and pyknosis or karyorrhexis and infiltration of the neutrophils, or maybe chronic leading to macrophages and gliosis, and or maybe hemorrhagic, due to rupture of the artery or aneurysm. This is the blood supply of the brain, mainly by three vessels: anterior cerebral artery supplying the anterior part of the brain, middle cerebral mainly concerned with the temporal lobes, and the posterior cerebral concerned with the occipital lobes supply. This is the thrombotic middle cerebral artery giving rise to brain trauma. Hemorrhagic anterior cerebral artery involving anterior parts of the brain related to intraparenchymal hemorrhage. Histopathologic progression of the CNS infarcts, starting with the edema, then red neurons, then infiltration of the polymorphs and monocytes, and then lastly gliosis. Hypertensive cerebrovascular accidents, they may be intracerebral or they may be involving the basal ganglia, lenticulocerebral arteries of internal capsule and putamen may be affected. This is later lenticulocerebral arteries that may be, if it's affected, that can be giving rise to this problem. Hypertensive CVA, because of the intracerebral hemorrhage, that will be leading to the problem. These are the lacunar infarcts. Slit hemorrhage, you can find out. Subarachnoid hemorrhage, that is because of the rupture of large intracerebral arteries, which are the primary branches of the anatomical circle of Willis. It may be due to congenital berry aneurysms or atherosclerotic process and result of a direct wall rupture. This is the circle of Willis, and you can find out that anterior cerebral arteries are communicated by the anterior communicating artery, and they may be having small berry aneurysm at the junction that involves that nearly 40% of the risk. Then there will be middle cerebral artery, then they may be having 20% risk for the berry aneurysms and 34% risk. And the posterior communicating artery, if this posterior cerebral artery has the 4% risk of the aneurysm. Again, circle of Willis. Again, ruptures berry aneurysm in the brain, base of the brain. Now we come to the hypertensive encephalopathy. It may be acute or chronic. That may be followed by acute hypertensive encephalopathy may be followed by headache, confusion, anxiety and convulsions, and the chronic will be showing its sequelae as dementia, multi-infarct dementia or gait disturbances and the basal ganglia symptoms. Next, we will study tomorrow. Thanks.